teachers, good morning, children, and good morning, everybody else. Good morning, Feversham. Welcome to our live Feversham Assembly, our weekly assembly. This week we have a great lineup for you. We have the fabulous Mr. Rotherham, who will be doing some live music, and then Mr. Fawkes with his inimitable Mullah Nasruddin story with us. And we also have Miss Armstrong sharing some new learning with us as well. And the children's work will also be shared at the end as well. So before we begin, just a few words from me. The theme this week has been back in time. And when we look at what's happening now, this is a historic moment. All of you, when you grow up, children, you'll be looking back and this will be back in time. People will be talking about this period as a historic moment. So one of the things I would recommend you all do, keep a diary that when you can look back to in years to come, capture what it was like during this period. So this will be back in time for many of us when we look back. So, and I know Mr. Lindley this morning has got a fantastic quote which loosely is connected.
It says about before we got on to that. Yeah. It just made me think of Anne Frank's diary.
Brilliant, sir. Yeah.
It was I know it's something year six has learned about. But that was a moment in time, and she's probably having similar sort of feelings.
Absolutely.
At that time, because it was happening at that time. And you've said it is a moment in history. But on to words of wisdom, or quotes of wisdom. Ignorant people raise questions that wise people answered 1,000 years ago.
Right, brilliant. Okay, so ignorant people raise questions that wise people answered 1,000 years ago. Wow. So let me see if I can kind of explore that a bit more. So does it mean that ignorant people just ask questions without checking first or without even looking at whether something's being explored?
I don't mean
explored?
Ignorant in the rude sense. I mean ignorant.
Not knowing. So pretty much most things in human understanding have been discovered or have been talked about. Somebody somewhere in the world will have written about experience, explore the idea. And nowadays, I think with Google and with all the digital books that are available, you can access anything. And I was thinking about this the other day, that we have more access to knowledge than the entire scholars and libraries of the ancient world. You know, on one device, we can have access to over 1,000 books. And yet in the ancient world, if you had 10 books or 100 books, that was regarded as a huge collection. So we have more access to knowledge than any time in the history of the world. That is a great opportunity. So you can actually learn anything you want. There's no barrier to learning now to anything. You can actually learn absolutely anything, and so they're available for you to learn. So if you want to grow and develop, all you need is a little bit of will, a little bit of direction, and just a little bit of resilience as well. Because one of the things that we lack, we have a lot of information at our fingertips, but sometimes we give up too easily. So stick to what you're doing. Keep a diary, keep a note. It doesn't have to be an essay, but just a few recollections. If you haven't kept one, you could look back to since the lockdown happened in March and think about your experience, some memorable moments from that time that you would like to capture. And believe me, this will be a historic document. When you look back at this, you will see the world from a different perspective. It will be like you're going back in time. Okay, thank you, Mr. Lindley, as always. Huge words of wisdom. But what I like about your quotes, sir, is that they are practical. They are something that allows you to actually change your perspective on the world and also change yourself and make yourself a better person. So thank you, Mr. Lindley, for that. Okay, now, moving on. Mr. Rotherham, are you with us, sir?
Hi, everybody. Hiya.
Mr. Rotherham, we're waiting for you to entertain us this morning and enlighten us with
your
music and your sound, sir.
So we've had, it's been an interesting few weeks from a going back in time point of view. I've been sharing with classes in year 5 and 6 and also year 4 to some degree, a history of music. And when we look at the word history, it's made up of two words, isn't it? His and story. It's his story. It's not her story, because it wasn't the women who were writing the history. It was the men that were writing the history. And also it was the white men who were writing the history. So when I was at school, I was given this list. I will just present and I'll show you the composers that I was taught about when I went to school. And I did this with year 4, 5 and 6 this week. And we looked at this list of composers here that you can hopefully see in front of you. So we've got Mozart, we've got Beethoven, we've got Bach, we've got Chopin, we've got Brahms, and we've got Tchaikovsky. And I asked year 5 and 6 what all of these people had in common. And year 6 were very quick to point out that everybody here is a man.
Mr. Rotherham?
Yes?
Something that won't come, they've got fancy haircuts.
They have got fancy haircuts and they've got wigs, and that's a lot of that's something a lot of people pointed out as well. And we spoke about why people wore
German as well. Mr. Lingley's comment was all German.
Yeah, so they're all European as well, and that's because it was the European white men who were writing the history. We spoke about why they wore wigs, and that was because people didn't wash quite as much back then. And the hair would get very greasy and very horrible. So they would wear wigs, and the wigs became ever more elaborate. So if you look at Mozart's wig, the first one, that's quite a small wig. But then when we get to Bach, we're having these enormous wigs. But the important thing is that they are all men and they are all white. And that's because it was white men who were writing the history. So what I wanted to show you today was an alternative to that.
So Jimmy, can I just ask you a quick question?
Sure.
So does that mean there were no black or non-white composers in history?
It's a very good question that. There was some black composers in history. However, why do you think their music isn't remembered well today?
We've never heard of them, Jimmy. So, I mean, I've certainly not heard of any from that list that you put up.
It's an oral tradition.
Yes. So Mr. Folk said it's because of the oral tradition, because the music wasn't written down. So that's part of the reason why it hasn't survived. Because again, if you weren't white and European, it wasn't included in the history. So what I found today is a video which shows a history of black music since slavery. And this is what's often missed out of school history of music programs. So I'm just going to share this with you, and I may talk about some of the things as they come up. And hopefully, so going back to the days of slavery. So Africans brought all their culture to America when they were taken to be slaves, and they used the instruments to communicate, and that led to the slaveholders actually taking their instruments away, the big meanies. And then so they took the instruments away from the slaves, and so the slaves had to sing and use their bodies to make music, much like we do at school. And one of the things they found very comforting was the idea of the spiritual, of singing about their religion. And this was a way of expressing things that were so upsetting that they couldn't express them in words, so they expressed them through music instead.
rest so hard they could not stand.
So they would make reference to the Bible, and they would beg for freedom, and they would identify with the Israelites in the Bible, and the Israelites were thrown out of their land and kept as slaves. So they identify with the Israelites, and a lot of the songs were actually about the Israelites.
Let my people go.
So the Lord said, go down.
Go down.
Moses.
Way
down in Egypt land. Tell on Pharaoh.
I said, roll. So this is from the film 12 Years a Slave, and you can see he's really upset, and all he can think to do is actually join in with the singing. And then that sort of music became what they then started to sing about as they were working. So these were the songs that the slaves sang while they worked, and they had really hard, back-breaking work, making railways. So Scott Joplin, and you'll recognize that piece of music, it's used a lot all around the world. And he was one of the first kind of black people to be recognized as a global success. He was recognized all over the world. Probably the first black composer really to have that kind of recognition all across the world. But we also had a backlash against that, and that was the white people trying to keep the black people down, and they would dress up as black people, like this man. This is a white man, and he's dressed up in blackface, and this was something that the white people used to do quite a lot. It's very offensive, and black people get very upset by this now, as they should, and it's quite disrespectful. It's not really done in a respectful way. It's done in a way which stereotypes the idea of black people.
And after, still being continued through to Little Britain.
Yes, and it was even, there was a big show in the 70s, the Black and White Minstrel Show, where people were still doing it, even though it really upset people. And yes, as Mr. Falk says, Little Britain was still using blackface, and it does upset a lot of people. So then we had the blues, and the blues is a great way of just expressing how sad you feel about it. This is Robert Johnson. Robert Johnson was so good at the guitar. He was so good at playing the guitar and doing the blues. I'm trying to pause this video. Robert Johnson was so good. Robert Johnson was so good at playing the blues that I can't pause this video. Stop. I'm supposed to be talking you through all this, and I can't stop the video. I was going to say, Robert Johnson was so good at playing the guitar that people thought he'd met the devil at the crossroads and sold his soul in it in order to be able to play. I'll just let the video play because it will not stop.
You made me cry.
Oh, it's paused now, finally. Unfortunately, the video isn't playing very well, so it's not really doing justice to how good the music of all these people was.
Put a link on the website so people can access the video.
I will put a link on the website, so yeah. But we had blues, and then blues gave way to jazz, and musicians like Duke Ellington. Jazz has been a huge influence on 20th century music, and also on pop music now. So all the pop music we listen to, and this would even include the sort of nasheeds that people like Ahmed Hussein are doing, they all owe a big debt to the history of black music. So going on a bit further, if this will... Oh, it's just absolutely not moving or doing anything, this video now, so I apologize. I think I will put a link onto this video so that people can see it. But the main thing to think about is where does our music come from that we listen today? And actually, if you look into the history of it, a lot of the music we listen to, certainly a lot of the popular music we listen to, comes from Black America. And in the 20th century, black people have been able to record the music, and they've been able to get a musical education much more than they could in history. But that's why we don't really hear about black musicians before the 20th century, because they weren't writing the music down. And also it wasn't appreciated by white people. It was seen as a lesser kind of music. So there we go. Yeah.
Quick question on that then. So, I understand the point about oral tradition, recorded, and certainly, obviously, in the European countries. But what about in, say, in the African countries or in the Asian countries? Did they not have any kind of the? Because obviously, they had control over their own story there. No, any composers or musicians of note that were recorded in their histories, rather than the European countries' histories.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, the history of Indian classical music goes back much further than Western classical music. It's hundreds and hundreds of years old. The traditions of Africa go back thousands of years, and they're passed on through families by the oral tradition, by singing the songs and learning them together. So that's how the music survives from passing it on.
So, Mr. Rotherham, what is it we can do now as listeners or as people who are engaging with music today to maybe to right some of this some of the absence in history? What can we do what message can we give to children in terms of what can they do now to kind of understand more about this?
I think that first of all, think about where your music comes from. Look at the history of it. So, for example, the electric guitar, a lot of the influence on electric guitar playing actually comes from oud playing from Arabic countries. For example, our pop music comes from the blues in America. Even composers like Mozart and Beethoven were influenced by Turkish music and wrote Turkish waltzes and things like that. So I think just try and understand that everybody's been making music, men, women, people of colour, Asian people, everybody's been making music for thousands of years. And just because some of the histories we learn don't include these people, and also women, they don't include women for similar sort of reasons, but we need to look at why our history doesn't include some people, and we need to look at who was writing the history and who had the power at the time.
Brilliant. Thank you, Mr. Rotherham. Any comments from Mr. Lindley or Mr. Fox before we move on?
I'd like to ask Jimmy, you mentioned it, was it Jenkins that you mentioned about selling his soul to the devil? Has that inspired the song The Devil Went Down to Georgia, the guitar riff thing?
Yes, there's loads of references to it, to Robert Johnson. There's a song called Crossroads as well, which is a very famous blues song, and that was about... Robert Johnson meeting the devil at the crossroads. And what it was he was so good at playing the guitar that they thought, well, the only way he could possibly play guitar like that would be if he'd met the devil. And I think he kind of then quite liked this story and was quite amused by it and kind of kept the myth going, if you like. Yeah.
So there's something for your children. At my age, you can still learn.
I'm beginning to think the way Mr. Rotherham plays the piano, he's definitely met the devil.
Well, there seems to be some theme going on here. But anyway, thank you so much, Mr. Rotherham, and thank you, Mr. Lindley, for your comments. Mr. Fox, then, over to you. That's a very nice link.
Okay.
A man's not inspired by the devil.
Can you all see me? Right, good. Okay. It's interesting how our morning assemblies, when I see Mr. Lindley and Mr. Idris sitting in their little cubicle, it's like going back in time to a proper Sufi meeting. I think perhaps the Feversham should become the first Sufi academy. That would be a real step forward in time. Hey.
Okay, yes. So Mr. Rotherham, can you stop presenting, then we can see Mr. Fox?
I certainly can. Apologies.
Yeah. Oh,
sorry, Mr. Fox. We can see you, but everybody else can't see you. So now the whole world can see you now, Mr. Fox.
Can't get the staff these days, can you? Apologies.
Yeah, sorry.
Okay. Right. Okay, so this morning I'm going to try and do for you again a new story about, guess who, Nasruddin. And when I'm wearing this, I am Nasruddin. Now, part of the point of my stories is to show you how easily you can tell a story with just a few simple props.
Just stop you one more. We can't actually see you. Just one moment. We can't actually
see you. You can't see me?
No, we can hear you. We've got a bit of a technical hitch. I'm not sure why that's happening. Mr. Hassan, can we get to the bottom? Oh, that's fine. Go ahead then. That's fine.
Is that okay?
Yeah, carry on.
All right, just a minute. It's helpful if I can see myself. Right, can you still see me?
Yeah, go ahead, sir.
Okay, right. So obviously the point of these assemblies and these stories about Nasruddin to entertain everybody with a nice idea for the day, and also to show you how, with just a few simple things, you can change your voice and your body and your character when you're acting. So you all know this is Nasruddin, and in today's story we also have a judge, and if I'm wearing these glasses, I am going to be a judge, okay? There is one more person in the story, if I'm wearing this, then I am a different character altogether. Okay, good. So the only other important things in this story are if this is my narrator here, and then there are three things to show you. The first is that Nasruddin is wearing these old sandals, and the toes stick out the end. That's very important. Because also in this story, there is this large rock, and you will see what happens with the rock in just a few moments. Finally in this story, there is 10 pounds, and the 10 pounds is going to be very important near the end. Okay, here we go. This story is called A Curse Equals a Fine. A curse equals a fine. Now, back in the time when Nasruddin was alive, you could be punished for all kinds of things. In every town, there would be a court with a judge, and you could find yourself in court in front of the judge for all sorts of reasons. You might have stolen your neighbor's cabbages. You might have sold somebody some rotten eggs. You might have let your goats or sheep eat on somebody else's fields. And anyone could be sent to the court to face the judge for using a curse, or what we would most likely call a little bit of swearing. Now, not swearing at somebody else, just cursing when you do something stupid, Let me give you an example. Imagine you go to a cupboard, you open the cupboard, and all kinds of things fall out of the cupboard on the floor. It's very hard not to make a little curse. Imagine also you're cutting with a knife, and you manage, you're not concentrating, and you're cutting the carrots, and you cut your finger, and you go, oh, and you quite often make a little curse. Or you might have tomato ketchup, and you squirt tomato ketchup, not on your plate, but all down your shirt and your trousers, and it's very hard not to make a little curse. But the problem in Nasruddin's time was that if anybody heard anybody else using a curse, especially if they thought the curse was at them, they would run and tell the judge, and the judge would almost certainly give them a fine to pay, like this.
Mr. Islam, your neighbor heard you shout at your donkey when you ran off. You shouted, come back, you son of a stinky sausage. For that, Mr. Islam, you will pay a fine of £5. Or it might be this. You, Miss Granger, your neighbor heard you using a curse when your washing line fell down in the mud in your back garden. She heard you say, son of a long green cucumber. You will pay a fine of £5.
So, you may be beginning to wonder now, what happened to Nasruddin? Did a clever man like Nasruddin really end up before the judge? Did Nasruddin use a curse? And did he have to pay a fine? Now, one day, as it happens, Nasruddin was walking from town out to visit an old sick friend. He was walking down a long, narrow alleyway, which he had used 100 times. It was so hot, he was wearing his nice old sandals, and he wasn't looking where he was going because he was too busy thinking about a funny story to tell his friends. And so, yes, there was this donkey, and the donkey was walking along, and he looked up at the sky.
You son of a butter biscuit! Who put that butter biscuit rock in front of my foot?
Nasruddin grabbed his sore foot and hopped up and down.
You son of a butter biscuit! Unfortunately,
Nasruddin was not alone. A man, another man, happened to be working in a field just the other side of the alleyway. He thought the comment about the butter biscuit was directed at him. He thought Nasruddin was calling him the son of a butter biscuit.
Hey, what was that? You just called me a butter bee. I can't even say the words. Hey, you. Did you just call me a butter biscuit?
The man was so offended, he went straight to the court to speak to the judge.
Wait a minute! I wasn't speaking to you! I was talking to this rock that hit my foot! Oh, no, come back! Come back!
There was no stopping the man. Before Nasruddin could move, the other man was at the court speaking to the judge.
All right, silence in court. We will hear this man's case who has just come running in. Tell us your complaint.
Oh, your honor, I am a peace-loving man, your honor, and I was working in my field near the old alleyway. I was just pulling up weeds, causing no offense to anyone, when all of a sudden I hear words which I cannot repeat here, your honor. Twice this man called me son of a butter bee.
What words did this man exactly use?
He called me, forgive me, your honor, he called me son of a butter biscuit.
Do you deny that you use these words?
Your Honor, I did use these words, but this man is mistaken if he thinks that...
Did you, said the judge, did you say, son of a butter biscuit?
Well, I did, Your Honor, but I was talking to a rock about my foot.
No excuses, said the judge. You do not deny saying, son of a butter biscuit. You will pay the court the usual fine of £5 for saying a curse.
Nasruddin had no choice. He handed the judge a £10 note. The judge took the £10 note and started to search for change.
Just one moment, I will look for the change. Nasruddin asked,
I take it that the fine for cursing at someone is £5, not £10.
Yes, yes, that is correct, it is correct. Okay then, said Nasruddin, keep the change, you son of a butter biscuit.
And that is the end of today's story.
Thank you, Mr. Fox. I love the punchline, sir. Love the punchline, absolutely.
You've got the punchline. Don't go around saying son of a butter biscuit to anybody. It can get you into trouble. But just occasionally, it is excusable if any of us do occasionally use the wrong language if we're not harming anybody, I think might be one of the meanings.
Mr. Fox, good. Thank you so much for that. That was absolutely brilliant. Lots of lessons to be drawn from there. And as always, a great performance, sir. Enjoy your butter biscuits.
Thank you.
Okay. Right, guys. I think we are going to be moving on to Miss Armstrong, who's going to be sharing something. So I think we're just going to finish off from live, from the live broadcast here now. Just a quick few messages. Okay, so let's put on video. Right, okay. So can you see me now? Okay, guys, thank you very much to Mr. Fox for that fantastic performance. Some great lessons to be there about lessons to be learned about etiquette and politeness. And obviously people do get frustrated at times, and it's about using your language carefully and understanding people's emotions as well. Now, just a couple of things before we say goodbye from school. School is open for children. If any children want to come in, please talk to your teachers. We have a bit of capacity. We'll be sending a letter out later on, maybe next week, about the capacity we have. But you must let the office and your teachers know before you come into school so we can make the arrangements for everybody. Other than that, enjoy the rest of the assembly, and we will see you all next week. Thank you very much.
Good morning, Feversham family. Miss Armstrong here, just wanting to wish you all well and hope that you're safe and happy. During lockdown, I have been spending my time doing a lot of reminiscing. Now, reminiscing means when you think back to your past and events, and I've been thinking about what I used to like doing when I was in primary school. Now, me and my best friend Caroline used to love making things. Now, this would be about out of anything that we had in the house, things that were recyclable, anything we could get our hands on. We used to like going down into my basement and we would pretend that we were TV presenters and we would make things whilst telling our imaginary audience what we were up to. We did this all the time, all during our weekends, and it was really creative and just really fun. Also, when I was little, I used to really want to have a Sylvanian family house, but we couldn't afford one. So I thought, why not combine these two memories and make a Sylvanian family house? So all you need are some very basic resources that you'll probably have in your houses. Cardboard box, cat is optional, some toilet roll tubes, some kitchen roll tubes, some paint, some glue, perhaps some string, any other craft resources you can find. I've got some pipe cleaners and some wooden lolly sticks, and then you'll also just need a lot of patience. Now, I was making this during my evenings, and I found it really therapeutic watching a movie and just having a go at doing some crafting. It's also really good for making up stories. You can add in characters and then perhaps write a story to go with it. You can role play, anything you want. And above all that, it looks really pretty. So please, guys, have a go at home at making your own house, building, farm, park, out of any recyclable resources you can find. And please take pictures and ask your parents to send them in. Email them to your teachers, and I will be running a competition to see who has made the most creative resource out of recyclable items. Good luck!